project was about taking a vessel, converting it into a home, and then taking it on a 5,000 kilometer trip.
Stødig was a 100 person survival lifeboat that came from the side of a Scottish ferry.
It was one of two lifeboats that travelled around the Western Isles of Scotland aboard a ferry called the Clansman.
Stødig's first journey was to be from the south coast of the UK in New Haven, up the northern European coast to Sweden, and then on to the whole of Norway, up to Tromsø in the far north. It was neither a record attempt nor an endurance challenge. It was deliberately slow.
Thank you.
Gali and I met at Cardiff University studying architecture over 10 years ago and have been good friends ever since. We always had this idea that we wanted to take some time out and do something a little different. It started off as a hiking holiday to Norway.
When we were studying and afterwards, we used to go on camping trips and go hiking in the Brecon Beacons. And we've always talked about what's the next adventure, what's the next big thing.
Over the course of the project, it's gone from being something very small to something rather ambitious. And after many iterations of the plan, the strategy, we settled on a lifeboat.
And we started to think maybe we could do something cool with this. Maybe we could recycle a disused lifeboat that didn't have any future use and do something with our design skills and do something that applies a lot of what we've learned through studying and working as architects, but also apply it into something we're really interested in, which is exploring and adventures and self-sufficient travel.
The boat was built for safety, not speed. And that was perfect for us, looking for something which limited our scope to go fast.
It's extremely rugged and durable and safe, but also spacious, has a large flat floor, and as boats go, is really cheap. You need a good friend that you trust and rely on and get on with well enough to spend that amount of time on a boat with together. And there's no one else I'd be able to do this sort of project with. And I think Dave recognizes that as well. And so we make a good team because neither of us would do this with anyone else. My father and my uncle were both in the Navy. My grandfather always had a boat in a boatyard that's now closed down just around the corner from where we have the lifeboat. And so having grown up around boats, it has always seemed like a natural way to do an adventure. One of the things that interests me about this project as a design challenge is getting the most out of the space we have aboard the lifeboat. It's half the size of a one-bedroom flat, but we're trying to build two cabins, two bunk beds, a generous living area, as well as all the equipment we need to drive the boat.
I think what's different is that we're taking a kind of vessel which is very rarely converted to this use and take it on a very long journey to climatic extremes.
We hope to carry enough fuel, enough water. We will produce power through our solar panels. Our composting toilet means we don't need to reach pump out facilities. In bearing all those things in mind in our design of the lifeboat, we hope to be as self-supporting as possible. Once we arrive in Norway, the idea is to live in Tromsø for a year to find work and to use the lifeboat as a vehicle to explore the Arctic coast of northern Norway and some of the harder to visit places that exist up there. The biggest challenge of the conversion has just been the sheer scale of the work involved. I think when we first looked at it, we thought this won't actually take that long, maybe a couple of months, maybe half a year. Over a year later, and we're still not completely finished, and we'll constantly be improving the lifeboat. When we got the lifeboat last February, the initial thing was to strip it out, to remove the seats for the 100 people that would have been evacuated in it before, and generally strip off the systems that we wouldn't be needing in our conversion. The second phase was then to chop the stern off the lifeboat. So cut a sizable section out of the back of the boat and then build a new stern cockpit. The phase after that was when we got the boat out of the water. We lifted the boat out and had it on the hard standing for about a month. During that time, we anti-fouled the boat. We filled any holes that needed to be filled. We also made the fairly major transformation of repainting the boat yellow from orange. The boat went back in the water, and we've been converting the interior. One of the big challenges has also been, not only do we need the time to do all these jobs, we also need to learn how to do a lot of them. Learning about marine electrics, marine plumbing, our propulsion systems. Our diesel engine is our primary form of propulsion, and unlike a sailing boat, we won't have the ability to lift the sails if our engine fails. And so we hope that we know our engine back to front, but inevitably there are things that you can't repair at sea. There's quite a lot of daily and weekly maintenance on all of our systems on board that we need to stay on top of. Working out how to do all of those and install of those ourselves has been a challenge that we maybe hadn't anticipated quite how long all of that would take.
We took the boat out for our first sea trial. Everything worked as expected. All our systems are up and running, navigation-wise, engine, everything. And luckily we had quite a calm day for it. Yeah, a bit of a swell in the ocean, getting a bit of a taste of what the roll and pitching of the boat's gonna be like. But otherwise, nothing much to report, nothing bad at least.
Tomorrow we're going to be doing the last bits on the boat, making sure everything's clean and ready to be loaded. And then we're going to be pulling all our bags together, pulling all our ropes and anchors and various bits of kit together, and loading it all onto the boat, hopefully finding enough storage lockers and spaces for everything we want to take, and saying goodbye to everyone before we set sail.
Overall, this voyage should take 4 months. If we wanted to, we could really do it in a couple of weeks. But the idea is that we're going to take a slow adventure all the way to Tromso.
I've always said that it was probably going to be Norway before we knew it was going to be a boat. But the beauty or the excitement is being able to find places, see what's around the next headland. Sometimes it's the places which you don't intend to go to that you end up spending the most time at, or you find something which you weren't necessarily looking for to begin with.
New Haven Harbour, this is Stødig, Stødig, requesting permission to leave the port. Over.
Take us away. just arrived in Belgium after a very early morning start from Dunkirk. Before that, we had come across the channel from Dover, but we managed to jump the shipping lanes and head to France in a long 40-mile day. We cast off at 4 a.m. this morning, still dark. We navigated out of Dunkirk along with some fishermen.
Why do we leave so early?
We needed to make good use of the tides so that... I'm not a sailor. Come on, I don't know, why did we leave at 4 o'clock?
Up north through the Islemere and the Markelmere, which are two inland seas that lead up towards the Frisian Islands and the North Sea again. We haven't quite decided whether we're going to go back out into the sea or go through the inland waterways, but with some low pressure in at the moment, the weather is a little unpredictable, and so I think we're probably more likely to keep going through the inland waterways and keep making our way to the Kiel Canal.
We've been getting used to life aboard. We've started to make ourselves at home. We had our first visitor when my brother came for the last 5 days as we've traveled through the Netherlands, and it's been good getting used to what the boat's like with an extra passenger on board. Now we're getting ready to go back out to sea. We need to make our way around to the Kiel Canal to pass through into the Baltic to go up to Copenhagen. Going next?
So we're heading to Copenhagen. We aim to be there by the end of the week, and we'll see what the islands of and the archipelagos of Denmark have to offer on our way.
This afternoon's been a little more rocky than our previous 2.5 weeks. We've had intermittent engine problems the last kind of week or so, but we've been kind of diagnosing them and sorting through them, thinking that we've identified problems, fixed them. But today our engine cut out in the middle of the passage between Copenhagen and Helsingør. We spent 3.5-4 hours digging around in the engine bay, and we came across what we think was the actual fuel pump in the engine. It wasn't actually delivering the fuel at the required pressure. The engine would turn over and get up to full revs, but then cut out and die. So here we are now with the Danish Coast Guard being towed, unfortunately, to the nearest port so we can properly fix the engine.
We've been working on the engine after our unfortunate breakdown last week that led to us being towed to shore by the search and rescue. The engine needed a new starter motor,
which had to come from the UK. So that's why we've been stuck here for the last week. It arrived this morning and we installed it this afternoon. Today is a success because we have fixed the engine. Everything seems to be working fine and we're excited to have sorted everything out, stowed everything away. We should be back on our way and hopefully won't have any other problems.
We are now at anchor, north of Varberg, where we spent the last 7 days repairing the engine again. It's been a frustrating 2.5 weeks. Lots of setbacks, making changes, replacing parts, and finding that the problem persisted, figuring out different ways of bypassing various parts of the engine so that we could pinpoint exactly where the problem was. We finally came around to something to do with either the coarse fuel filter or the actual engine fuel tank itself. Luckily, we have hit Sweden, which is where we were planning on slowing down a bit, doing fewer miles every day. We started out with a schedule of where we're going to be on what dates. We reckon we can pull a few larger days and catch up.
Just arrived in Norway. There was a big storm yesterday, and after we'd cleared the last of the islands in Sweden, we found that the waves were really out in full force. It was a pretty rough day getting over here. It tested the boat. It tested us and our resolve, and we're pretty glad to be in port. We're glad to be in Norway, and we look forward to hopefully some slightly calmer seas. Don't know what happened there.
Keep going.
We're looking forward to starting to go around the bottom of southern Norway later in the week. Quite a nice anchorage. I suspect some of
fucking navigating
through there. Might be a bit shallow. Yeah. Just a really nice town and then a good place to get into the national park.
Well done. Oh, you caught it. You caught it.
Yeah. We received our first guests in Norway, making our way to Lysefjord and Preikestolen. Explored the fjord, saw some waterfalls and the first of the dramatic Norwegian scenery that we were so excited about. Had some beautiful anchorages heading up towards the Stad headland and towards Ålesund, trying to anchor the Norwegian way with a stern anchor out the back of the boat and the front of the boat tied to some trees. We then started to make our way up to the Stadland at that peninsula. It's a notorious headland which it's some of the worst of Norway's weather, being on its most western point. The mist descended, and then out of the mist emerged the looming headland of Stad.
We came around the Statlandet Peninsula the end of last week and have since then dived into more protected waters. And so what we've done is we've come down one of the longest fjords, at the end of which is Geranger Fjord. And now we're taking our time, going to stop the boat and float around in the middle of the fjord, do a bit of fishing, swimming. It was nice to take things a little bit slower after the passages around the exposed headlands. Spent the last over a week now heading all the way up around the Hustadvika exposed coastline before heading back into the areas beyond the Atlantic Highway. Finding, you know, a lot of time to drop anchor, stop the boat. It's, you know, a great change of landscape. It's a little bit lower and a bit more barren. It kind of feels a bit like Scotland at the moment. So it'd be nice to explore somewhere a little different from the grandeur of the fjords that we've left behind us. We spent the last 2 weeks weaving our way up the coast from Trondheim. At the moment we're in Buda Harbour, waiting out a little bit of a storm out in Vestfjord. The landscape around here has been really quite dramatic. It kind of dropped off a bit around Trondheim and a little bit further north, but we've suddenly kind of hit dramatic mountains that rise straight out the water. We are hoping to skirt a little bit further up the coast to the north before making the passage across to Lofoten.
So we are something like day 110 or 115 of our voyage. So far we've done 2,500 nautical miles, that's over 4,000 kilometers with all the little excursions we've made, all the detours. Days often feel quite long, but then the weeks pass by really quickly. When Dave and I look back at things we did a month ago, it often feels a lot longer, sort of experiences we've had on the trip. It was quite unexpected when September suddenly came around. It felt much earlier in the summer.
We are quite near Tromsø now. The weather is turning in on us a little bit more every day. So it is a logical place to end the journey for this season. It feels like a lifetime ago that we left New Haven. It almost feels like a different trip or a different voyage.
We're gonna keep going along the south coast of Lofoten, moving further to the east, continuing on our gradual journey up to Tromsø, where we should arrive in about 2 weeks' time. We can just see where the weather takes us and enjoy the freedom of being on the move before we settle down in Tromsø for a little bit. When we started planning our Norway adventure, I'd been working in lots of different countries as a self-employed architect and living quite a transient existence. Never really having a base started to take its toll a little bit. And having enjoyed the voyage on the lifeboat, it's quite clear to me now that I'm in Tromsø that actually I want to feel slightly settled. I started a job in an architecture practice in Tromsø. I've been making friends, trying to play sport, and quite enjoying going back to a routine. The lifeboat seems to have been the vehicle for realizing that that was what I wanted to do.
The slow speed of Stødig sounds like a restriction, but actually it allowed us and encouraged us to live at a much slower pace, being at the mercy of natural cycles and elements did, you know, allow me to reflect on what I wanted to do or achieve over the next couple of years, and trying to retain an element of not having a schedule. Being able to work when I need to work. It's a fantastic way to balance what I originally came here for and what I need to do to be able to sustain it.
Not only was the lifeboat slow, but the pace of our life aboard was slow. And that gave us opportunities to lead our day-to-day lives based on weather and tides and the landscape and coast around us. Although we're enjoying being based in Tromsø, we're also excited to get back out to sea at some point and make a few trips slightly further north to see that last remaining bit of the Norwegian coast we haven't quite visited yet.
After Stødig's first journey here to Tromsø, it will go on to have many more, whether with us or someone else. But hopefully never in a hurry.